Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar series, where great professors teach you. My name is George K. Wilson, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Odyssey of the West, A Classic Education Through the Great Books, Part 1, Hebrews and Greeks. This course is taught by a variety of professors, each of whom speaks to a subject of his expertise. Professor Timothy Shutt of Kenyon College serves as the host, while Professors Eric Klein of George Washington University, Peter Meinick of NYU, Kim Hartswick from the City University of New York, and Lawrence Schiffman of NYU all contribute lectures on the early history of Western civilization, which is the subject of this survey. The integrated program in humane studies at Kenyon College has inspired this course, an interdisciplinary overview of Western culture from its origins in the Middle East to the present day. In the lectures that follow, we will draw upon the resources of a wide variety of fields, from history to philosophy, to literature to art history, engaging the deepest and most profound aspects of the West. A variety of professors, each an expert in their field, will contribute their view of the subjects that have formed the basis of the world we know today. Listening to them, we will address those ancient but always relevant questions that we all have. What is the best way to live? What's the most important part of human life? Does existence make sense? Is there a God? Each of our professors has a unique viewpoint on these topics, and their observations will teach us more about who we are and how we should plan for our future. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and, yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin Odyssey of the West, A Classic Education Through the Great Books, Part 1, Hebrews and Greeks. Lecture 1, From Sumer to Athens. And now Professor Timothy Shutt.
How can I be happy? What's the best way to live? What's the most satisfying way to live? What is the good? Is the good something built into the nature of things? Or is it something that we make up, a convenient fiction, or an expression of our own wills and wishes? Is morality conventional, just an act of social convenience? Or does it come from above? Or is it really and truly an effort to embody in our lives a value which we can clearly perceive and which exists in some sense in its own right? Is it something out there that we can work towards? Or no? And what about this world? I see people who are unhappy all over the place. Things don't seem to be going the way that I would have made the world. Things don't seem to be going the way that I like. People get sick. They get old. They're mean to each other. Does it all make sense? Is the world finally comprehensible, morally, or even in terms of purely rational, non-moral description? Can we account for things, or are things random? Do they just happen? Is there a God? Are there gods? Or do we live in a world which is constituted only and entirely by random flux? For reasons which I can't understand, lots of people don't think of a course in Western Civ as a way to find the answers to these questions, to the extent that we can find the answers to these questions. But in fact, it's the best possible place to look. Because what a study of Western culture records is the most far-reaching, influential, and, in a sense, long-lasting answers to these questions that have ever been proposed. And they are perennial questions. To be human is to ask them. What we'll be attending to in this course is the ongoing conversation about just these central issues, which begins in recorded form in Sumer sometime around 3000 BCE, before the Common Era, and extends in an unbroken chain of conversation and mutual influence to the present. You are not alone in addressing these questions. These are the questions which everyone, in one sense or another, consciously or no, has had to answer, has had to struggle with, since the birth of what we think of as the human mind. In this course, then, we're going to take a look at the full sweep of Western tradition from the beginnings all the way up to the 20th century. We will take a look at the works which have most enduringly and most decisively shaped the tradition, the works to which people have returned generation after generation, century after century, for illumination on just these issues. Another way of putting it, these are the works that have had the most far-reaching influence and the most profound influence. That influence derives, in the most general sense, from two sources. One, a kind of intrinsic artistic or philosophical merit, and in the second case, from impact, from influence, from the fact that these particular works initiated a conversation or initiated a turn in the conversation which has continued with greater or lesser intensity ever since that time. Because the works that have shaped and questioned, and shaped indeed in the process of questioning Western culture, have done so by and large because they addressed perennial questions. Questions which were important when they were first raised, and questions which are important to us still. It's easy to imagine that an effort to acquaint oneself with the past is a kind of archaeology dealing with works which have a historical importance, but which no longer have anything of contemporary interest to say to us. The premise of this course is that that is, in fact, not the case. Indeed, the premise of the course and the premise of a classical education is that there is no more valuable way to spend your time in the course of educating yourself than by studying these great works whose influence has endured for so long. It's worth pausing for a moment to reflect on what liberal education means. It doesn't mean necessarily an education which is going to make you either conservative or liberal, or presupposes either a conservative or liberal viewpoint in a political sense. In fact, it's originally the education which was suitable for a free person. A person who is fortunate enough to find himself or herself in a situation where they did not have to devote all of their efforts to securing the means to sustain life, just to stay alive in a biological sense. It's an education for people who, in a classical context, were not enslaved, did not have to work with their hands. It's an education as time has developed, which pursues the things most worth pursuing, and in a contemporary context, and indeed for the past 2,000 and more years, has proved to be uniquely effective and valuable as an education for leadership. It's a learning how to address, in their own right and on their own merits, the most important questions, to learn how to think, how to think clearly, how to express oneself, and what has been most effectively expressed and thought in the past. And liberal education has been, for 2,500 years and more, in one guise or another, a token of social advancement and a means of social advancement. A training for wisdom and virtue, a training for leadership, which in varying degrees, admittedly, in varying times and places, but to some degree, at least in most times and places, has been open to all. But now on to the specifics. The organization of this course is chronological by and large. We will go through a sequence of great works, beginning with the Epic of Gilgamesh once again and ending in the 20th century. And we're going to be casting a very wide net. We'll be drawing on works which are ordinarily studied in the contemporary academic world, contemporary colleges and universities, in a whole variety of departments. But most of the works, the overwhelming majority of the works that we'll address, were written in a time when there was no such thing as disciplines and departments as we now think of them. For that reason, and to keep the net wide, we'll be addressing works which you might encounter otherwise in a course in history, a course in philosophy, an English course, or a course in literature more generally, art history, religious studies, political science and political philosophy, the history of science, these among others. Because in fact, cultural developments in one field, always and everywhere, are affiliated, arise in part from, and feedback to, developments in other fields. We will be addressing then a multifaceted, multidisciplinary, ongoing cultural conversation, a vast, deep, and powerful stream which has been flowing in traceable guise now for 5,000 years and more. We'll have two central goals. First, to address on their own right and in historical context some of the most prominent and influential works ever written, and the answers embedded and embodied in those works, the vision of the world embodied in those works, not only for their historical value, but even more significantly, with an eye toward their value for us in the here and now, with an eye toward assessing their continued relevance and value for us. Secondly, we'll be seeking to provide a sort of map or template of the process of cultural and historical development as that has unfolded, a kind of conceptual framework which, so we hope and so in fact it has turned out for people who have undertaken such study in the past, which will provide a conceptual template or framework in which you can array and situate other things which you might learn. Where does Louis XIV of France and the culture of the world of Louis XIV of France, for instance, fit? What is he responding to? What currents does he express? What currents does that culture express? And what effect did he have subsequently? Where does Aquinas fit in the grand scheme of things? And so on and so on and so on. Those are the sort of questions, in addition to, as a grace note, as it were, beyond real-life questions, which this course is meant to help answer. all these ends in view, let's pause for a moment so that I can outline for you the format of this whole grand endeavor. It'll consist of 6 courses, each of 14 lectures, for a total of 84 lectures. Each of those lectures is to be delivered by one of a series of scholars and experts drawn from a variety of disciplines and from many different universities and colleges. Our purpose here, of course, is to assure that we have experts speaking about each of the works we address, and experts drawn from various disciplines so that the course is intrinsically interdisciplinary. I myself will be serving as a guide of sorts and will be drawing connections between the various works which we discuss and introducing each of them for you. And now it's time to begin the story, and we'll begin at the very beginning, however briefly, with human origins. As we know, 4 million years and more ago, with Australopithecines of various kinds and their kin, modern humans, though, and there's some contention about this, seem to have arisen in Africa, more specifically in East Africa, around 100,000 years ago, some evidence suggesting actually a bit before that. And for a time, there were 3 or even 4 human species on Earth: Homo sapiens, us, Homo neanderthalus, the Neanderthals, Homo erectus in Asia, and perhaps recently discovered some small humans who may or may not have represented a separate species in Indonesia. Be that as it may, around 40,000 years ago, something seems to have happened, and something of wide-ranging impact. Up to that time, up to about 40,000 years ago, give or take, the human toolkit had remained more or less unchanged for hundreds of thousands of years. And suddenly, in a geological eye blink, we have a technological explosion. Immensely sophisticated stonework, bonework, nets, and so forth. And with it, for the first time in anything remotely resembling contemporary elaboration, we have art. Most famously, the art appearing in caves, particularly in southwestern France and the neighboring regions of Spain. At that point, whatever happened, we became, or by then we most assuredly were, in the full sense, us. For a time in Europe, Neanderthals and humans, full modern humans, lived, if not together, adjoining one another. By about 30,000 years ago, the date keeps getting more and more recent as new discoveries are made. The Neanderthals died out, and all that was left in the world were modern humans and, by this time, technologically very sophisticated modern humans. This was also the Ice Age, however, what in North America is called the Wisconsinian Ice Age. And as the Ice Age began to wane, for the first time, which we have detected in any case, human beings began to abandon their perennial hunter-gatherer style of life and to emerge in settlements, settled communities. And it's no accident that this took place in the Middle East. The Middle East, as it happens, particularly the northern part of Mesopotamia, southern Turkey, the Fertile Crescent, and adjoining regions, is uniquely blessed in animals and plants which are domesticable and worth domesticating. In particular, we had the ancestors of emmer and einkorn wheat, barley, peas, and lentils, all of them viable and productive crops. And we also had a uniquely rich assembly of domesticable quadrupeds, herbivores, sheep, goats, cattle, and pigs. And on the basis of those plants and animals, for the first time ever, farming communities developed. It's worth pointing out that other regions of the world, with presumably no evidence to suggest otherwise, just as advanced people, did not have the assemblage of suitable plants. Notoriously, the Americas did not have anything resembling horses or cattle or so forth. Llamas and their kin in South America, nothing readily domesticable in North America. As a result, the largest domesticated animal was the turkey. Prospects in Australia were even less promising, which is one reason that farming did not begin there till 1788 with the arrival of the British penal colony. Agriculture changed things in all kinds of ways. Most notably, it led very quickly to a population explosion, and in conjunction with the population explosion, a decline of sorts in living standards. The skeletal remains of hunter-gatherers, by and large, are the size of well-nourished modern humans. The first farmers are about 6 inches shorter, have horrible teeth, and show all sorts of signs of disease, but nevertheless, there were a lot more of them. A lot more of them with a lot more stuff. Hard to have a lot of stuff if you're always on the move. And having, by all appearances, a lot less fun in life. Farming is very, very hard work. Hunter-gatherers, at least recent hunter-gatherers, have to work about 3 or 4 hours a day to feed themselves. The life of a farmer, particularly a low-technology farmer, is very, very much more arduous. So it was a mixed gain. Relatively shortly after that, people in the Near East took the next step to full-scale urbanization, and with it, civilization. So what is civilization? This is to some degree a controversial term, particularly in relatively recent years, where folks have wanted to resist the notion that any one culture is more advanced than another. But nonetheless, taking that effort towards cultural sensitivity into account, civilizations have various structural characteristics which differentiate them from other cultural groupings. And here are some of them. And these are what arise for the first ascertainable time, or so far ascertained time in any case, in Mesopotamia, to be specific, in what is called Sumer, sometime around 3500 BC. First major city is the city of Ur. It's mentioned in the Bible, in fact. Ur is very near what was then the shore of the Persian Gulf. The silting and whatnot have assured that it's further away now than it was then. And cities are indeed a keynote, if not the keynote, of specialization. You can't have a city unless you are generating surpluses. And that, in every instance known to us, requires agriculture, and effective agriculture. Cities, by definition, include people who are not farmers. and hence specialization of labor to some degree. Up until very recent times, and in many places even still, the overwhelming majority of people were engaged in farming. But from the outset, in cities at least, some were not, living off the surplus of those who were productively engaged in agriculture. This specialization and the fact that some people are living off surpluses generated by others marks the origin, in a new sense, of class, social class. This is not to say that in hunter-gatherer bands, people aren't differentiated to some degree in status by age, to some degree also by gender, to some degree by capabilities and abilities, but arrangements in that sort of situation are much more fluid than they are in any kind of city. And also, arising with city is a new mode of organization, generally speaking, in religious terms, and certainly and inevitably something which we can call a formalized government, which manages the surpluses, if nothing else. There are other characteristics that are less universal, but still hallmarks of civilized cultures. Public works, which again require surplus, originally public works in temples and in ancient Mesopotamia, very important because of the lay of the land, quite literally, canals to facilitate agriculture, and also changes in intellectual life. Within 100 years or so of the archaeological remains of Ur in Sumer, we find the first instances of writing, and shortly thereafter, mathematics of some sort, arithmetic, attempts at astronomy, and so forth. So there is a whole cultural package that comes in the train of urbanization. Shortly thereafter, too, defensive walls and often armies. Sumer was a very, very long-lasting culture, and pretty much the entire civilization package which we've outlined, they, for all practical purposes, invented. And their language has affinities with no extant language which has ever been identified. Be that as it may, though, they set the template for what followed for the better part of 3,000 years or more. Soon enough, another group entered the picture with a fundamentally different language, which with some variations held sway for the better part of 2,000 and more years. The language is Akkadian. It's a Semitic language, which is to say that it's related to Aramaic, Hebrew, and Arabic, and presumably the Akkadians were ethnically different from the Sumerians and felt themselves to be so. They were certainly linguistically different than the Sumerians. What's surprising is that they adopted Sumerian culture in its essentials, even artistically, more or less lock, stock, and barrel. More surprising still, at least to me, the Sumerians had invented their writing system, cuneiform, about which we'll have more to say in the next lecture, and the Akkadians took that over too. For a long while, Sumer consisted of Uruk, a variety of city-states, and the first real empire that we have on record is founded by a man named Sargon. Sargon's hometown was a city named Kish between the Tigris and Euphrates. He built himself a new capital at a place called Agade, and his empire was substantial. It ran from Turkey through what's now Syria all the way through what's now Iraq into parts of Iran. Then, after Sargon, we go through a long and elaborate series of contesting empires in the Middle East, which last up till the time, in fact, of Alexander the Great of Macedon, and indeed beyond for 2,000 years. No point in running in detail through the list of Elamites, Hittites, Kassites, Babylonians, Neo-Babylonians, Middle Assyrians, Neo-Assyrians, and so forth that constituted the ebb and flow of political power in the Middle East over the 2,000 years under discussion. But we should even so address several cultural high points. High among them is King Hammurabi and his famous laws. In the old Babylonian Empire, Babylon and Assyria fluctuated in power and had several peaks of influence. The first in Babylon was, unsurprisingly, the old Babylonian kingdom, and Hammurabi is most famous for the promulgation of his laws. This is not to say that legal codes of one form or another were not in force in some sense before the time of Hammurabi, but Hammurabi's code is certainly the most extensive legal code that we have from very early times. And the notion of law itself, as opposed to vengeance or custom, is an intrinsic social development of major importance in its own right. Another major cultural development, issuing from yet another Semitic group, the Canaanites, among whom were the Phoenicians, who lived along the Syrian and Lebanese coast, as we would designate it today, is the invention of the first alphabet. The Canaanites developed it, the Phoenicians took it over, the Hebrews perfected it, and the Greeks perfected it even further. The huge advantage of the alphabet is compared with other early modes of Western writing. It embodied fewer than 30 symbols and was easy to use and mapped not the meaning but the sound of the language, which was a much easier, if counterintuitive, proposition. Hieroglyphics and cuneiform, the writing of ancient Egypt and of the ancient Middle East, by contrast, were immensely complicated systems which were in practice mastered only by professionals, which is to say, scholars. The Assyrians were great collectors of artifacts and books, great and ferocious hunters, and militarily the marvel and terror of their times. There had been armies before. I am not sure that any army up to that time, and relatively few since, has shown the efficiency, devotion to the task at hand, and ferocity of the Assyrians. The ancient Hebrews, of course, one of the major roots of contemporary Western culture, were themselves one among a large panoply of Middle Eastern groups. And the Middle Eastern component in Western culture stems most prominently from the Hebrews themselves, almost as old as the ancient Middle Eastern civilizations was the civilization of Egypt. Egypt's influence, though, on Western culture was in a curious sense, so it seems to me, less direct and less powerful than that of ancient Mesopotamia. The reasons for that have to do with the character of Egypt itself. Egypt consists, in practical terms, in terms of agricultural potential, of a long, narrow strip of land on either side of the Nile River, which, of course, runs through what is now the Sahara Desert. The Sahara Desert, even today, let alone in the past, represents an almost impenetrable barrier to invasion. Ancient Egypt was nothing if not defensible, and indeed, to the best of my knowledge, they never endured a threat from the Sahara on either side. By and large, Egypt was left free from the outset to develop in accordance with its own genius without the necessity to confront hostile outsiders. One result of this is that Egyptian culture had an unexampled stability. The basics of Egyptian culture remained more or less constant from 3100 BC or thereabouts, when Narmer, or Menes, as Herodotus calls him, succeeded in uniting Upper and Lower Egypt being the northern part, the Nile Delta, Upper Egypt being the river valley beyond that, Upper and Lower referring to the direction of Nile flow. From those beginnings to the last of the Macedonian rulers of Egypt, Cleopatra, 3,000 years later, Egyptian culture remained in essentials unchanged. Well, in our next lecture, we're going to return to the Middle East and take a look at the first surviving, substantial literary work dating from the time and from the period, the Epic of Gilgamesh, the legendary semi-mythical king of Uruk and Middle Eastern culture hero par excellence.
This ends Lecture 1. Odyssey of the West, Part 1, Lecture 2, The Epic of Gilgamesh. And now, Professor Shutt.
Of him who found out all things, I shall tell the land. Of him who experienced everything, I shall teach the whole. He searched lands everywhere. He who experienced the whole gained complete wisdom. He found out what was secret and uncovered what was hidden. He had the stone wall of Uruk built, which no future king nor any man will ever match. Go up to the wall of Uruk and walk around. Inspect the foundation platform and scrutinize the brickwork. Testify that its bricks are baked bricks. Son of Lugalbanda, Gilgamesh perfect in strength, son of the lofty cow, the wild cow Ninsun, two-thirds of him was divine and one-third mortal. So, in the standard Ninevite recension, discovered in large part in the library at Nineveh, the capital of the late Assyrian Empire, so begins the Epic of Gilgamesh, the oldest epic or quasi-epic work that we have. To say that Gilgamesh experienced the whole and gained complete wisdom, found out what was secret and uncovered what was hidden, raises a series of fairly obvious questions. As the culture hero of the whole region of the ancient Near East, which in some substantial sense Gilgamesh assuredly was, he clearly has to do something remarkable. But then what is that remarkable thing which Gilgamesh does? In essence, as we'll see, it's the exploration of the full range of human possibility as that revealed itself to these irrigation-based early urban cultures. And also, and perhaps more importantly, it reveals the final limits to all human striving. So Gilgamesh is a heroic figure, in many respects as heroic a figure as the Middle Eastern culture of the time can imagine, but part of his heroism and a big part of the interest of his heroism consists precisely in the limits that he finds to his achievement. In some sense, Gilgamesh was evidently a historical figure. There exist Sumerian king lists encoding the semi-historical, semi-legendary early kings of Sumer, all with biblically long lifespans. And one of the kings of Uruk on such lists is, in fact, Gilgamesh. So if he was historical in any sense, which presumably in some sense he was, he would have lived about 2800 to 2500 BCE, before the Common Era or BC. Sumer itself, of course, had been in existence at that time for the better part of half a millennium. Sumer and Uruk were supposedly founded sometime around 3500 BC or BCE and before the Common Era. And as we saw in our last lecture, Sumer is the oldest of anything we could readily consider a civilization on record. It took a little while to formulate writing, but within a century or so, by about 3400, they had developed the beginning of the cuneiform script, which was to remain the basis of communication in one guise or another throughout the ancient Middle East for 1,000 and well more years to come, closer to 2,000, as a matter of fact. It is, if you have ever seen a tablet of cuneiform, a very daunting kind of script. Cuneus is a pencil-like wooden rod, and what they would do is they would take a material which was in abundant supply in the region, mud, clay mud, make a tablet of the clay mud, and then incise wedge-shaped configurations of signs or marks which had a syllabic meaning. Some of these configurations of signs and marks are very elaborate, indeed at least as elaborate as, say, Chinese characters. And as a result, literacy in cuneiform culture was always a professional achievement, something which was only open to professional scribes. It took a long, long time to gain literacy, and likely enough, that impeded the development of the use of writing for such secondary, non-business, non-goods and services-oriented activities as literature. Nevertheless, we have documents like the king lists emerging fairly soon, and ultimately we get various versions of the tale of Gilgamesh. The earliest, of course, were in Sumerian, but most of the surviving records of the many, many versions of the tale of Gilgamesh which we have are not in Sumerian. They are, in fact, in Akkadian, which is, in one dialectical variant or another, the language of Assyria and Babylon. This raises a series of interesting questions in its own right. Sumerian is a very mysterious language, and indeed the Sumerian people, the founders of civilization, are mysterious in their own right. To the extent that scholars have been able to ascertain, Sumerian is in fact related to no known language. It is not a Semitic language. It is not an Indo-European language. It is not related to the Chinese family of languages. It seems to stand, so far as can be told, more or less on its own, in the sense that something like Basque stands more or less on its own. Very peculiar, and all the more peculiar because the syllabic writing system which the Sumerians devised, and it is no model of efficiency, it gets the job done, but in a difficult way, that writing system was taken over by the various Akkadian-speaking groups who eventually succeeded to power in the region. And along with the writing system, though they maintained their own Akkadian language, they took on the tales of the Sumerian. Very definitely Sumerian culture hero Gilgamesh of Uruk, and adopted him as a hero of their own, in their own significantly different culture, at least in a linguistic sense. Akkadian is a Semitic language, like Arabic, like Hebrew, like Aramaic, and it had a very, very long run as a kind of lingua franca in one guise or another throughout the ancient Middle East, running certainly from before 2000 BCE to 500 or later BCE, 1,500 years. So the equivalent of from the time of Beowulf to the present for English, with a good deal less change and variation than that. As it happens, even though the original versions of Gilgamesh were formulated in Sumer and presumably began as oral tales before they got written down, the versions on which the standard text is based are not written in Sumerian at all. They're instead written in Akkadian, and it's more complicated than that. In fact, as we'll see, the textual situation with regard to Gilgamesh is almost unimaginably complex, vastly more so than something like the Iliad or the Odyssey or even the Hebrew Bible, which is a tangled enough skein in its own right. The standard version, evidently, comes from an Akkadian version written by a person, we have the name of this scribe, Sinlegi Unini, from the, again, mid-second millennium, BCE, the so-called Kassite period, but the actual tablets that we have, which in one version or another comprise what we usually think of as the Epic of Gilgamesh, date by and large from the remains of the library at Nineveh, the capital of the late Assyrian Empire, which was destroyed by a revivified Babylon and the Medes on their way to joining, or more precisely being taken over by the Persians, who destroyed Nineveh in 612 BCE, and in the process burned the library of Sennacherib and Ashurbanipal. This had the curious effect, and very unbook-like effect, of firing these clay tablets, with the result that they became, in effect, bricks, and hence virtually indestructible. They can be cracked up and lost, but they don't decompose in many generations of human time. And hence, the destruction of Nineveh led to the survival, rather than the destruction and loss, of a vast amount of cuneiform material, some of which is the Epic of Gilgamesh. A small proportion, at all times cuneiform, was used mostly for administrative purposes. But nonetheless, we have a substantial number of tablets from that library in Akkadian, and they form the basis of the text that we usually read. If you consider that Gilgamesh was first written down in Sumerian, as far as we can tell, or the earliest evidence we have in any case would suggest, during the reign of King Shulgi of Ur in the 2100s BCE, the version of Sinlegi Winini dates a good half millennium later, and the recension that we have, the text that we have, dates to almost 1,000 years after that. You can easily see that Gilgamesh remained a culture hero and an important figure throughout that Middle Eastern region, that Near Eastern region, for the better part of 1,500 years, and indeed perhaps more. Some people have seen echoes of the Gilgamesh story in such unlikely places, even as the Odyssey. But even that doesn't conclude the difficulties that the text of Gilgamesh provides, because though many, many tablets describing Gilgamesh are extant, no complete version of the story has survived. Instead, what we have is an array of variants, some more substantial than others, some indeed evidently the remains of schoolboy exercises, where people were copying out versions of Gilgamesh and none too skillfully. And in fact, we have an old Babylonian version, which preserves important features which are not in the standard version. We have Sumerian versions. We have Hittite versions. Hittite is an Indo-European language which was spoken in what's now Anatolia or central Turkey. There are even versions from the Mediterranean coast. So over the course of 1,500 years, with who knows what Semitic language and Indo-European language versions, the tale of Gilgamesh keeps reinventing itself generation after generation. On that account, any version of the story of Gilgamesh, which you may choose to read, represents an editorial selection. Some editors have chosen to go for coherence and readability, which necessarily, to some degree at least, falsifies the fragmentary nature of the evidence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.